ونعوذ بالله من شرور انفسنا ومن سيئات اعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، اشهد ان لا اله الا الله وحده لا شريك له واشهد ان محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم. فهو كتاب الاعتصام بالكتاب والسنه، The Book of Holy Fast على القران عن السنه او الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم، قام صحيح الإمام البخاري رحمه الله تعالى. يقول: باب إثم من آوى محدثا. باب إثم من آوى محدثا. Chapter if sin. The sin for those who would give a sanctuary for a محدث. محدث literally means something, someone did something, an action. But in this context mean that the people of innovation, people of deviation, people of bid'ah, people of sins that they are being sought for a punishment, and people would hide them and give them sanctuary when they're supposed to hand them over or so. That this is a sinful act. He said, رواه علي عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال حدثنا موسى بن اسماعيل قال حدثنا عبد الواحد قال حدثنا عاصم قال قلت لأنس أحرم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم المدينة؟ قال نعم، ما بين كذا إلى كذا، لا يقطع شجرها، من أحدث فيها حدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. قال عاصم فأخبرني موسى ابن أنس أنه قال أو آوى محدثا. He says that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the narrator of the hadith, he said that he asked Anas رضي الله عنه, did the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم made المدينة حرام؟ حرام meaning that it's certain things that are permissible elsewhere becomes haram in Mecca and Al-Madina. Mecca is haram, right? As we know, in which certain things become forbidden, like the hunt, the game, and cutting the trees, and taking the luqata. If something, a person finds something on the ground, he's not supposed to pick it unless he would make ta'rif for it, to make it known to people, to give it to the authorities for them to. If somebody do something, they will go to them. But to claim it, which is elsewhere permissible, it depends. And again, as we said, if it's of a value, then a person would have to announce it and keep it for a year. After the year, if nobody comes forward and claim it, then it's his. In Mecca and Medina, there's no such a thing. So Mecca is haram, is known. But Medina, the question here, did the Prophet ﷺ made at Medina haram also, or it's only Mecca? He said, yes. ما بين كذا إلى كذا. He said, yes, from this point to this point. We talked about that last time. And then he said, لا يقطع شجرها. Its trees is not to be cut. And then he said, من أحدث فيها حدثا فعليه لعنة الله والملائكة والناس أجمعين. Whoever commit a crime or a sin in it, is the curse of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on him and the angels and all mankind. That means the sin in Al-Madina and also the sin in Mecca. The punishment of it is multiplied. And as in the Quran it mentions that the intention to commit a sin, right, in the haram, it's by itself a sin. When a person would intend to commit a sin. Whoever wants to do in it any form of a crime or a sin, a punishment from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is severe. Because of the importance of these two places, Mecca and Medina. And the point of the hadith here, أو آوى محدثا, or if he gives sanctuary to a محدث, to someone that committed a sin, people looking after him, or someone, a person of innovation, that they're looking after him because he is a cause of deviation to others, it is not permissible to protect him, to hide him, and so on. It becomes a major sin. Then he says, باب ما يذكر من ذنب الرأي والتكلف القياس. باب ما يذكر من ذنب الرأي والتكلف القياس. The chapter of what has been mentioned about dhamm al-ra'y. Dhamm al-ra'y means accusing or the evenness of opinions. When a person would refer to opinions when there's a text. Referring to opinions when there's a text. When there's something in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet mm-hmm. So this is what al-ra'y means. Although al-ra'y means opinions in general. But what is condemned is not the opinions based on the Quran and the Sunnah. It's the opinions based on desires or based on even if it's analogy, when there's a text, when there's an evidence from the Quran أن سنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم وتكلف القياس. القياس is analysis and القياس is one of the means of extracting the rulings, and this is usually comes after the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and the consensus. Then علماء, some will take the qiyas, some will take the weak hadith, some will take the deeds of the people of Medina. This is where the differences of opinions comes from and the four school of thoughts and so on. But they all agree on the first three principles, that if the matter is in the Quran, the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or there is ijma' consensus, then the matter is over. There's no need for referring to anything else. So takalluf al-qiyas or al-qiyas is one of the principles of extracting the rulings, of course. But what is condemned here is takalluf al-qiyas. The person will make takalluf. They would make analogy when there is no need for it, because the matter is clear. There is a verse in the Quran. There's hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So why refer to opinions? Why refer to make an analogy or qiyas about an incident happened when there's already a clear text saying this is halal or this is haram, and so on. So this is the chapter that Imam Bukhari gave the title here. He said, وَلَا تَقْفُوا أَيْ لَا تَقُلْ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ, in Surah Hud, verse number 46. لَا تَقْفُوا مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمَعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا. Which means, do not say what you don't have knowledge about. Do not say anything without knowledge. And as we mentioned before, this is one of the worst of the sins, as it's mentioned in the Quran, in the order of what is worst, what is less, what is less, what is worse. The last one, which is means, comes after the shirk, which is worse than associating partners with Allah, is to speak about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge. This is the root for all evil. This is the root for innovations in a deen. The root for shirk even. This is how people would associate partners with Allah. Someone would start something by saying, inventing something, liking something for people to do when it's not based on clear evidence. It's not based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. A person feels good when he would do something or say something. So he would call people to do the same, and the shaitan would adorn it to them and they would feel good, right? And as a result of that, they would make it part of the religion. And the bid'ah or the innovation in the deen does not stop at that level. Has to by the work of the shaitan, and this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth. It gets worse and worse, and it can take the person outside the fold of Islam. And the evidence of that is, if you remember the hadith, the long narration about Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, when he saw the people making dhikr in a way that was not seen at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, circles and a heap of pebbles, and the leader is saying, say subhanAllah, so they will say subhanAllah till they finish and then say alhamdulillah and so on. And he got so angry, and we talked about that before, but the point in this narration is that these people, they were doing nothing but matters of this. This was not according to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. It was innovation in the religion. It did not stop at this level, because in this narration in Sunnah al-Darimi, that the same people, as the narrator of the hadith, he said, كَانُوا يُطَاعِنُونَنَا يَوْمَ النَّهَرَانِ, that we saw them stabbing us in the battle of النَّهَرَانِ. It led them to be from among the Khawarij, right, those who fought against the Sahaba of Allah. So it started as a good thing, good intentions, making dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, being extremist in matters of ibadah, extremist meaning that it's not according to the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But the shaitan, once the door of fitna is opened on the person, that means there's no principles. It's not about this act itself. It's the disease in the heart. It's the attitude of the heart that a person, it's okay for him to do something the Prophet ﷺ didn't do in matters of the deen. Once this disease is in the heart, then anything else after that will come from the same disease. Whether it's a small deed or a major deed, it doesn't make a difference, because the disease is already there. So this is what one of the real danger of matters of innovating in the deen of Islam. Till again, the shaitan, his goal is to take the person outside the fold of Islam. It's not this one sin here or there, right? The shaitan, his concern is to make a person a disbeliever, to make him die in state of disbelief. Even though the person, he thinks that he is far away from this, but the shaitan, as they say, bilhah wa fi ilyas, he is too pushy, and he never give up, and he keeps on with the person, and his kite, his plots is so weak, if it's opposed with ikhlas, with sincerity, following the way of the Prophet ﷺ. That's why when we keep on repeating these principles, It's to protect our deen and protect our hereafter and protect our life. It's principles, not this action or this action. It's the principle itself that we worship none but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we follow none but the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is again what we need to follow when we ask the people of knowledge. We ask the people of knowledge, those who this is their way, this is their methodology, and they would speak based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So to refer to the opinions when there is the evidence, the main call of this is to the people of knowledge. Because the layman, he would not be able to differentiate between an opinion and evidence in the Quran and the Sunnah. So it's mainly to the people of knowledge, this amana, this trust that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala entrusted them with, not to hide the book of Allah or the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, a covenant that has been taken from one generation to the other, from the people of knowledge, that they do not hide anything from the deen of Allah. So as a result of that, if they know that the opinion is opposite or against the clear evidence from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and they would say with the opinion, because they would blind follow whatever, this is cheating to the Ummah. This is deceiving the people. And they will be asked about this in the Day of Judgment, and it won't benefit them that I'm following this great righteous big scholar. This is, if he's a person of knowledge, that means he has the ability to differentiate, he has the means to know, then it's not permissible for him whatsoever to blindly follow based on opinions. The normal person, this is when the person can be excused, because he's still, the normal person has to take the means. He has to take the means in what? In the evidences? No, he cannot understand that. He's not a seeker of knowledge. His effort is to be done in trying to find the person of knowledge. So if it happened that he's in a certain part of the world, then this is what is available to him. And he thinks this is the person that will tell me the way of the Prophet ﷺ. And this person of knowledge deceived him, right? Who's responsible, of course, is this person of knowledge. But with the very important thing that every Muslim in his heart, his attitude, his way is, what is the way of the Prophet ﷺ? What was the deen then? Not the deen now, the deen then, at the time of the Prophet ﷺ and the early generations of Islam. So then he says the famous hadith, and it's mentioned here with different words in it, because as we said, Imam al-Bukhari rahimahullah, he would repeat the hadith in different places. But his way is, if the hadith is repeated with totally, or most of it, the chain of narration is totally different. That gives the hadith more authenticity this way. That means it came from more than one route. And as a result of that, some of the wordings of the hadith will be different. It says, حَدَّثَنَا سَعِيدُ بْنُ الْحَدِيدِ قَالَ حَدَّثَنَا إِبْنُ وَهْبٍ قَالَ حَدَّثَنِي عَبْدُ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنُ شُرَيْحٍ وَغَيْرُهُ عَنْ أَبِي الْأَسْوَدِ عَنْ عُرْوَةٍ قَالَ حَجَّ عَلَيْنَا عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بْنُ عَمْرٍ فَسَمِعْتُهُ يَقُولُ عُرْوَةُ بْنُ الزُّبَيْرِ He said that Abdullah ibn Amr, he came for Hajj and I heard him saying, سَمِعْتُ النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَقُولُ I heard the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saying, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَيَنْزِعُ الْعِلْمَ بَعْدَ أَنْ أَعْطَاكُمُوهُ انْتِزَاعًا That indeed Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala لا ينزع. ينزع is when something is taken by force. That's why they call when a person is dying, he is في النزع. Meaning that his is in his last moments of his life and the soul is being taken out. Right? So this is something that is taken by force. This is the nazar. So the word here is used in Allah la yanzi'u al-ilm. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not take the ilm. بَعْدَ أَنْ أَعْطَاكُمُوهُ انْتِزَاعًا He does not take it from you انْتِزَاعًا انْتِزَاعًا مَفْعُول مُطْلَق right? Which means gives the strength of the action here. When you take something by force, I don't know if you literally would be clear if I say it literally, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not take the ilm after knowledge, after He gave it to you, taking it by, you know, the word taking is mentioned again. It means by force also. So this is not from the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that the ilm is to be taken out, to be lifted. Right? وَلَكِنْ يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنْكُمْ مِنْهُمْ But how it is lifted from the people? مع قبض العلماء with the death of the علماء قبض العلماء قبض is one of the words used for death right and you can use it also for transactions when you take the money from someone or you take the good from someone. And that's why the ulama, they made it a condition, right, for you to be owner of something, is that the qabda has to be there. You have to take the merchandise in your possession. And they go on with definition, how what it means to be like this. Meaning, the Prophet ﷺ, we're going to some another direction here, but because of the word qabd, the Prophet ﷺ, he forbade us from selling something that we do not own. Do not sell something that you do not own. So if a person, for example, he's in trade, and someone comes to him, and you know, he wants to purchase a car, right? And he knows that this car is by his friend. So he says, yeah, sure, I sell it to you. And he shows him the pictures and everything. He doesn't own it. And he sells him the car by the pictures, and he go get it for him. Is this permissible? It's not permissible. He has to have it in his possession first, for him to be permissible for him to sell it. Means if it burns, if something happens to it, he's responsible for it. So what does that define it? Does he have to, say for example, he would call his the other lot, right, and say, I purchased the car in your lot, this number, this, that. And he said, yeah, sure, it's yours. Is this what considered to be qabd? Did he put it in his possession yet? Or does he have to bring it to his lot? So many issues like this. So the definition of what it means to be that you purchased something and it's in your possession. So why are we saying this? Because of the word قبض العلماء. ولكن ينتزعوه منهم مع قبض العلماء, which means when the ulama are being taken away, meaning by their death. So this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in which the knowledge is lifted. Not that it's taken away from the hearts of the people, from the people themselves. A person waking up in the morning and he lost the knowledge, or the books will be lifted and there's no books anymore, no, the ilm will be saved. Everything will be saved. And that's why it's so much abundance of it. You can get it everywhere. Books and the internet, and you see how easy it is to read any book. So easy. Does that mean that once this is there, that's all what we need? No, it needs the people of knowledge. And the people of knowledge would have the knowledge, the proper knowledge, and with it they have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because otherwise they can also be form of deceiving others. وَلَكَنْ يَنْتَزِعُهُ مِنْهُمْ مَعْ قَبْضِ الْعُلَمَاءِ بِعِلْمِهِ. So the alim will be taken away with his knowledge. And again, the word ulama is not the knowledgeable based on knowledge only. The word al-ulama means the one that has the knowledge and has deen with it. Right? If he doesn't have the deen, that means he's not a alim. And the ulama, they even when they talked about it, who is to ask commenters of fatwa, for example, right? They went into the extent of which, if he's a alim, someone to be asked for matters of fatwa, it is not, of course, permissible to ask him if you see him on a sin. Of course, if he is shown to be committing a sin, right, then it is not permissible to ask him for matters of fatwa and so on. And it is not permissible to call him a alim, even if he is the highest knowledge in the world. It doesn't matter. He is not a alim, right? If he is openly committing, even if it's a very small sin. A alim, for example, that comes and he shakes the hands of women, for example, things like this, or he's a person of deviation. He's not a alim. He has some knowledge, yes. He read a lot of books, but he is not a alim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا يَخْشَى اللَّهَ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. These are a special group of people. They have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the knowledge. They even went far on saying that if he is seen to be leaving or known to be leaving one of the recommended acts, and he's persistently leaving it, recommended, he's not to be asked for matters of fatwa. It's not how he's not committing sin. It's not like if he misses sunnah prayer, no. If he is, say for example, does not pray sunnah whatsoever, right? And he has a lot of knowledge. He can benefit from his knowledge, of course, if he's on the sunnah, but he's not someone that would be referred to in matters of fatwa and so on. If he's persistently leaving something altogether, of course, he might be following the sunnah by praying it at home, so we don't just judge by seeing something. But if it's known to be seen leaving something that is even recommended, but persistently leaving it, then he is knowledgeable, mashallah, no problem, he can teach the people, no problem. He's not committing sins, but not to be from this level of the people of knowledge. So this is the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on earth, is by the death of the alim. So the death of the alim is the real calamity. Why? Because the alim dies with his knowledge. Right? فَيَبْقَى نَاسٌ جُهَاد. So the Prophet said, فَيَبْقَى and it stays نَاسٌ جُهَاد. Nas, people, جُهَاد, right? Meaning ignorant from جَهَاد. They are ignorant people. So what is left are ignorant people, do not have knowledge. يُسْتَفْتَوْنَا فَيُفْتُونَ بِرَأِيهِمْ فَيُضِلُّونَ وَيُضِلُّونَ. يُسْتَفْتَوْنَا means they're asked for fatwa. فَيُفْتُونَ. So they answer, they give the verdict بِرَأِيهِمْ by their blood, by their opinion. فَيُضِلُّونَ وَيَضِلُّونَ. So فَيُضِلُّونَ, they will be astray themselves. فَيُضِلُّونَ meaning they would let others be astray, the one that asked them. وَيَضِلُّونَ and they themselves become astray and deviate. So they deviate and they lead others also to be deviated by answering with their opinions because they have no knowledge. And that's why the word here, فَيُضِلُّونَ بِرَأِيهِمْ, which is condemned, that means what person or the alim should give the third one. By opinion or by what? By what? No, not by what? By ilm. And al-ilm is what? Al-ilm is not raq. Al-ilm is not opinions. Al-ilm is قال الله قال رسوله قال الصحابة. ليس بتمويه as in al-qayyim said. قال الله قال رسوله قال الصحابة without no ambiguity in it. If the matter is something that is so new and there is nothing in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ and from the early generations of Islam, of course there is the ijtihad, right? But based on these principles, not based on just solely any opinions. But when someone would talk about their opinions to make it easy, or that's how they think, to make it easy for the people to blind follow someone, when the matter is clear with regards to the text, Quran and Sunnah, and the way of the early generations of Islam, then this is a form of deviation. Then the narration goes on by saying, فَحَدَّثْتُ بِهِ عَائِشَةَ فَزَوْجَ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. Who's the one that said this to Aisha radiallahu anha? Urwa. And Urwa is, how he is related to Aisha radiallahu anha, again as we said. Aisha is his aunt. His mother is Asma, the sister of Aisha radiallahu anha. So he narrated this hadith to his aunt, Aisha, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ثم إن عبد الله بن عمرو حج بعد فقالت يا ابن أختي. Then عبد الله بن عمرو, he came again. And عائشة رضي الله عنها, this is their eagerness of making sure that the matters of knowledge, they make sure that this is authentic and they ask about it. This is their concern in this life. The thing that drives them and make them sit and stand and do anything is قال الله قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سورة. So she said to عروة, يا ابن أختي, who son of my sister, right, nephew, انطلق إلى عبد الله. Go to عبد الله ابن عمرو فاستثبت لي منه الذي حدثتني عنه. فاستثبت. Ask for تثبت. Ask for authentication. Right? ثبات is when you're steadfast on something. So ask him for the steadfastness, which means the authentication of what you said. That's what you narrated to me from him. She wanted him to make sure that what he said earlier is true. فجئته فسألته. So he said, I went to him and I asked him. فحدثني به كنحو ما حدثني. So he informed me, he told me the same as he told me before. فأتيت عائشة فأخبرتها فعجبت. So when I came back and I told عائشة رضي الله عنها, فعجبت. She was amazed. فقالت والله لقد حفظ عبد الله بن عمرو. Said, والله عبد الله بن عمرو had memorized. Right? She was amazed that he memorized. And actually this is mentioned in other hadith. Abdullah ibn Amr was one of the people that would write the hadith of the Prophet. We know that at the time of the Prophet, in the beginning, he forbade them from writing his hadith. They would only write the Quran. And then later, the Prophet gave him the permission to write his hadith, his statements. And when Abdullah ibn Amr, the Prophet told them, Uktub, فَوَاللَّهِ مَا يَنْتَقُ إِلَّا حَقٍّ. He told them, write, Wallahi does not utter what is, except what is the truth. When the people of Quraysh, they said, he's a human being about the Prophet ﷺ, and he would speak at times of anger and times of ease. So how can you write from him everything? So when he said that to the Prophet ﷺ, the Prophet ﷺ told him, write. Because nothing will come out of it unless it is the truth. So which is an evidence that the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ also was written at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. So she said, لَقَدْ حَجِرَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ إِبْنَ عَمْرُ. We had memorized. So we see the connection of this hadith with the chapter. right? Those who would come after the ulama with their ignorance, they would give the fatwa by opinions. They would take the evidence that since there is an opinion, that means it's permissible for you to do it. There is no such a thing in the deen of Islam whatsoever. We're not saying that, of course, there's differences of opinion among the ulama. This is a valid thing. A person has to understand that and not to condemn one another just based on the fact that there is differences of opinions. But the principle that we need to pay attention to, that differences of opinions by itself is not one of the evidences to do or not to do. Right? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْتَنَزَعْتُمْ فِي شَيْءٍ فَرُدُوهُ إِلَى اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. If you differ among yourselves by a matter, refer it back to Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He did not say refer it back to your opinions. And to make it clearer, meaning when people sometimes they say, what is the ruling of this? So people would say, since there is differences of opinions, you can just take anything. Make it easy, right? Take whatever opinion is easy for you. Or if someone is doing something, he would take the fact that there is differences of opinion, that this is an evidence that what he's doing is right. This is not an evidence that what he's doing is right. We have to take from this, yes, that we have to recognize that there is differences of opinion. So we won't kill each other for it, right? There will be still Muslims, right, if it's a valid differences of opinions. And they would have rights towards one another, and there's the brotherhood is being there and so on, right? If there is a valid difference, not every difference of opinion, but it's a valid one. But to take this as an evidence about the deed that we do or not to do, just based on differences of opinion, there's no such a thing in the deen of Islam. And that's why, again, it's the responsibility of the people of knowledge. The next hadith in the chapter, or the last one in the chapter, he says, حدثنا عبدان قال أخبرنا أبو حمزة قال سمعت الأعمش قال سألت أبا وائل صلى الله عليه وسلم هل شهدت صفين؟ Did you witness صفين? صفين is the battle that was with among the صحابة رضي الله عنهم in the fitna at the time of علي رضي الله عنه معاوية رضي الله عنه. So did you witness that in a sense that how the things that happened in it? قال نعم فسمعت. He said yes. فسمعت سهلة ابن حنيف يقول حاء is the تحويل in the chain of duration, that means this is a, what's تحويل? Detour, yes, like a detour in the chain. وحدثنا موسى ابن إسماعيل قال حدثنا أبو عوانة عن الأعمش. So they meet at الأعمش again. عن أبي وائل قال قال سهل بن حنيف يا أيها الناس اتهموا رأيكم على دينكم. He said, oh people, اتهموا, accuse رأيكم, accuse your opinions over your deen. Accuse your opinions, but not accuse the deen. Accuse your opinions. لقد رأيتني يوم أبي جندل ولو أستطيع أن أرد أمر رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عليه لرددت وما وضعنا سيوفنا على عواتقنا إلى أمر يفضعنا إلا أسهلنا بنا إلى أمر نعرفه غير هذا الأمر. قال وقال أبو وائل شهدت صفين وبئست صفون. He says, O people, اتهموا رأيكم, accuse your opinion and not your religion. لقد رأيتني يوم أبي جندل. He's talking about himself. Meaning, you should have seen me in the day of Abi Jandal. Right? And if I had the ability to oppose the order of the Prophet ﷺ, I would have done it. If it was permissible for me to do that, I would have done it. What was the day of Abi Jandal? This in the Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, in the day of the Treaty of al-Hudaybiyah, that one of the conditions of it was that if a Muslim comes from Mecca, comes from the disbelievers, as a Muslim, fleeing away from them, that the Prophet ﷺ would return him back to the disbelievers. So some of the Sahaba, even Umar radiallahu anhu, they were so upset by this. How can a Muslim take us as sanctuary, he's running to us to save him from the disbelievers, and we hand him back to him to torture him, to kill him? And he said to the Prophet كيف نظر الدنيا في الدنيا في دنيا رسول الله. That means الدنيا, to accept the humility in matters of the religion. So the Prophet approved of this, and this was fatḥ, and the Surah al-Fatḥ was revealed, and the outcome of this is the liberation of Mecca and so on. But the point is, سهل بن أبي جندل, and the name is mentioned here, when the Prophet ﷺ, they were still within the treaty, they were still writing it down, not finished yet. He came from the disbelievers as a Muslim. And the Prophet ﷺ told them, right, leave me this one. Let me have this one. They didn't finish the contract yet. They didn't finish the treaty yet. And this man comes from the disbeliever side, right? And he wants to be with the Prophet ﷺ, but according to the treaty is the Prophet ﷺ has to hand it back to the disbelievers. So, and it's still not done yet. Like he could have said, we're not finished yet, so he's with us. Right? So the Prophet ﷺ told them, leave him for me. They said, no, the treaty is about him. Right? The whole treaty is depending on him. If you take him, there's no treaty. So the Prophet ﷺ let him to be going back to the disbelievers. And what happened is that when they were going back, he ran away from them. And he stayed by the Red Sea. Right? Which is not too far away from Mecca. And he made like anybody that wants to run away from Mecca, they would go join him there. Alone. He's not with the disbelievers, and he's not with the Prophet ﷺ. And they would, you know, cut the pass of the trade for the people of Quraysh, causing them so much trouble till they at the end agreed. So the point is, the Prophet ﷺ agreed that he is to be returned to the disbelievers, although the treaty was not finished yet. So this is what he meant. Means he wanted to say his opinion. This is, you know, to him, or to if you were to think about it, something, if this is something that happened today, some people would say this is wrong. And they would overthrow whoever says this. But how can you hand a Muslim this and that, right? And of course, there's many benefits to be learned from this. And that's why the people of knowledge are to be followed in these types of matters. Because a normal person would follow his desires. Follow his desires, not in an evil way. In an evil way, it's known, it's sin. But what is worse is when a person is religious and righteous and love the deen of Allah, love the Prophet ﷺ, right? And he would follow his desire like this, without knowledge. He can bring more evil to himself and to others based on the desires alone without knowledge. So it's something like this that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decreed for it to happen, so that people would submit themselves to the Prophet والسلام, and it proved to be this is the victory from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is what he said, and then he said, وَمَا وَضَعْنَا سِيُوفَنَا عَلَىٰ عَوَاتِقِنَا إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ يُفْضِعُنَا إِلَّا أَسْهَلْنَا بِنَا إِلَىٰ أَمْرٍ نَعْرِفُ غَيْرَ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ. That with regard to the swords, and they put it on the shoulders to something that would be scary to them, or something of a calamity or something like this, unless we always would go to something that we know, matters of fighting for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Every time they would carry the sword, they know for sure, clearly, that this was for the sake of Allah. There was no ambiguity in it. غَيْرَ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ, except this matter, this fitna that happened. So the matter is not clear then. That's why the worst thing about the fitna is not killing, is not anything, it's about the matter is not clear. That a person might end up being in the hellfire when he is seeking the goodness and seeking to make the words of Allah superior, having this intention or to seek that the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is superior alone is not enough. This can lead the person to the hellfire. The Khawarij, they had the same energy, but without knowledge. So that's why the knowledge is very important. And the knowledge sometimes would not be according to what you desire. It would be something to opposite to the desire. A person might be ordered to be patient, right? Because there's no means of whatever he is seeking. And whatever there is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to ask the people of knowledge. And the people of knowledge will be between the person and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the day of judgment. But if a person acts on his own, right, that means he should not blame no one but his own self. So he said, I witnessed Safin and Bi'sat Safun, which means how evil it was because of the fitna that happened. But after all, this fitna, it's something from the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when he said in the Quran about the nations before, تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ فَقَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. This is a nation that passed, right? For it, what it earned, and for you, what you earned, and you won't be questioned about what they did. So it's not permissible for the Muslim to go into what happened in the details of the fitna by the Sahaba and this and that, because there's no benefit in doing this, but there is a matter of aqidah here, matter of belief that we're supposed to have. And when we say matter of belief, it's not based on some historical facts or looking into incidences and so on. No, matter of aqidah. How do we know our aqidah? from the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So our عقيدة إن الصحابة رضي الله عنهم is not based on some incidences that happened. Our عقيدة, our belief in the الصحابة because the Quran says about the صحابة رضي الله عنهم رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنها and so on. So we love them for the sake of Allah, and we praise them and so on. And we this is our belief, and we do not base our opinions based on incidences. So that's why it's forbidden for the person to get into deep into this, because history is written by everyone. So a person reading and he might like this one and hate this one, right, based on the deficiencies that we have, right? So we would bring this deficiency in analyzing things that happened among the Sahaba when they were over this worldly gain that people are after. So people would try to explain what happened between them as going after the dunya or going after khilafah or things of that nature. And this is one of the fitna that caused a split to the ummah. So that's why the Muslim has to be careful. And our belief is based on the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. And whoever says that a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, for example, is a disbeliever, he is a disbeliever. He is the disbeliever. He's a kafir. Whoever says that a companion of the Prophet ﷺ, they became disbelievers after the Prophet ﷺ, or renegade, or whatever, because this is denying the Quran and denying the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. So again, this is with regard to condemning the opinions when the evidences are clear, when the matter is clear, meaning the way of the Prophet ﷺ, if it's clear. And again, this is to prepare ourselves. The way of the Prophet ﷺ won't be always according to what you want. And if you are the righteous man in the world, and you are the most sincere in the world, and your heart is so pure, you still do not know what is right and what is wrong. And this is a very important point that many do not understand. We think that once we are righteous and pure and so on, we will be able to know what is right and what is wrong. It feels, it looks, right? No. We have to have the knowledge. Intentions by itself is not enough. And knowledge means that it's in the Quran and the Sunnah wahy. That means people would not get it by their own feelings and their own sharpness of thinking and so on. No, it might be something totally opposite to what you think. Totally opposite to what you feel or what you think is going the means of victory, means of establishment, means of anything. We have to be followers and not but followers, and not to put forward our opinions. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the understanding of the deen. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam.